Namaste. I'm an engineering professor, and the joke is that we cannot say good morning without PowerPoint slides. So it's going to come up there. While that comes up, although the slide says welcome to Waves, I'm not going to welcome you to Waves. I'm just going to thank you for being here, because I think it's fair to say that you make Waves. Okay, you are Waves. You are the energy behind Waves. And so thank you very much for being here. Yes. So we have a conference that I'm sure will keep you quite busy. And hopefully, hopefully very engaged over the next couple of days. But most of all, this is a place where people see each other for the first time. Many of us have read each other's writings, so this is it. You put a face to the name, and this is a place to meet. It is also a place for people who have known each other for decades to meet each other again. So it's a place to renew friendships. So that is the real business of this conference. Dr. Tiwari ji told me, look, this is a serious conference. You can't stand there and be, just talk seriously. So I will try to do that. How did I get into this business? You know, this is something you worry about when you're sitting there panicking whether the conference is actually going to happen. So let me go back a long time and to my childhood. So I learned some prayers from my mother. That is probably my only formal training in Hinduism. I clearly remember where that was. It was in central Sri Lanka, sitting next to her in the evenings, because from 6 o'clock to 7 o'clock in the evening, it's curfew. We better be there. And it was prayer time. And we were, just incidentally, we were the only Hindu family in the neighborhood. And I was the only Hindu child in a school with over 2,000 students. Okay, so really, you know, there was nobody else to talk to about. I know a lot about other religions. I have formal training in those. But I was always afraid to try to write down the words. Because it's like, you know, people sing Hindi movie songs, but they don't have a clue what they're saying. And to quote my niece, very recently I became acquainted with my grand nephew, who is 6 years old. And he goes around singing all kinds of things, Michael Jackson's, and his mother says, I absolutely forbid him from, he knows how to get on the internet, by the way. I absolutely forbid him from reading the lyrics. As long as he doesn't know what the words mean, I'm okay with it. So I thought I would be like that. But as I got older, I said, I better write down these things because I'm getting forgetful. So I tried writing it down, and these days you can always go to Google Ishara and ask what is the right answer. The amazing thing was, let me see, let me go back one slide here. The amazing thing is that I was far more accurate in my words than I usually am in teaching engineering courses. I make a lot more mistakes than that on the board while deriving things. So that is a clear demonstration to me of the power of what we call the oral knowledge transfer. It is okay that the recipient does not understand everything at the beginning. It would be foolish to imagine that we will understand everything the first time it is taught, whether it is in the Vedas or engineering, it's the same. Over the decades, understanding grows, but the knowledge is within. So that is a very powerful tradition that I have learned the hard way, and since I have one datum, I consider that enough to prove the point, and that's good enough. The second part of that is, so you know, as I got into this, I decided that I wanted to learn a little bit more about our traditions. So my friends in Atlanta gave me the previous proceedings of the Waves conferences. And I think that's all of that. And I had a book called The Holy Vedas. I read those. I tried to read it. I couldn't understand much of it. In the process, I realized that I could not find these things on the internet. So it's shocking. my students will tell you that if you don't exist on Google Scholar, you don't exist. Okay, and our papers do not exist on the internet. So the first thing, useful thing that I did was to prepare a bibliography using what is called the BibTeX software, which is free, that you use with LaTeX, book writing and things like that. I'll be very happy to share that file with anybody who wants to do this, because we want these papers to appear on the internet. Okay, they're an absolute treasure trove, and they're really mostly unknown. I think Professor Tiwari here has read it, all of them. I have read a few, but beyond that, I'm not sure I know many people who have read these things. So the, on the other hand, WAVES has had huge impact. Okay, this, the papers presented and the people who did that and the communications, somehow, informally, WAVES has had a huge impact. I don't want to spend the next 3 hours talking about that, but take it from me, we could do a lot more. So my role here is that of a vidyarthi, one who desires knowledge. Okay, one who yearns for knowledge, you might say that. So I ask a lot of questions. I don't have the answers. The first is that I learned that the Rig Veda has over 10,000 ruchas. Incidentally, I learned that the plural of Rig is ruchas from no less than Professor Tiwari in the course of reviewing papers. These are supposed to have come from over 400 research groups. That's the best way to describe them. They were represented by perhaps over 400 rishis, acharyas, but they basically represented traditions that had gone back countless generations. They brought that knowledge together. They brought it into an amazingly succinct volume. And I assure you, I cannot imagine how this was done. Okay, this was no trivial effort, but it was done. And they came, at the end they said, it all boils down to one truth. That is an amazing PhD thesis if you ever get to something which says, I actually have a really defensible conclusion. They actually did this. How did they do it? And more to the point, why did they do it? And I'm not going to give you any answer. I'm just asking, why did they take the trouble? Why did they try to make it so succinct? And why did they decide to sit in the Sapta Sindhu regions in order to do this? Okay? That, of course, leads to a question. Who were these rishis? What were they like? I think I will ignore Professor Tiwari's warning and also add the comment, how did Veda Vyasa deal with the egos of all these 400 plus people and not get murdered? All right. So, but these are the questions that that occur to me. And so I just wanted to pass those on. Now, the other thing is, what were the research problems of the day? What were they arguing about? And as far as I can tell, they're the same as what we argue about today. The fundamental questions have really not changed. It's not that nobody has answered them. Their answers seem to have been brought out, but they keep getting evolved, and the eternal search for the truth goes on. And it comes down to, how did we come to be? Why? What is real? Why? How should we live our lives? Why? Why bother? So the question why is ingrained in our traditions, and we always ask that. We are a very argumentative people. We don't agree on anything, because at least that's a good thing. We keep asking why. So is this all about, that's the other question I get to. So this Vedic studies, and it's about people who lived either 800 years ago, according to some people, 2,000 years ago, 4,000 years ago, 13,500 years ago, 157,000, I don't know, or before humans. See, the term aparusheya, which is used to describe the original source of the Vedas, can be interpreted many ways. I interpret to say far before humanity ever existed. Okay, there's no reason for us to be arrogant and say this was all the knowledge was invented and ingrained into our genes after we became humans. So there's much to be gained by going back much further than that. And I, again, I don't want to get into all that. So is this all about arguing about history and archaeology? In that, I will take one more minute to explain to you the other fundamental truth that I discovered in the course of all these things. I was once sitting next to the chief of the Lunar and Planetary Institute in Houston, probably. And he was, you know, decorated veteran of the Apollo programs and all these things. And I said, Dr. Duke, can I ask you a really stupid question? Why is it that people see all these old stuff buried underground? I can understand, you know, Herculaneum or Pompeii, volcanic eruption covered everything in rock. Some other place, you know, Dwaraka went under because of, but in other places, why is it that they dig down? Do you know, how many people know the answer to this? I'm sure, you know, it's, and he was very kind. He didn't say, you're a professor. He said, gravity. Gravity makes stones sink relative to loose soil. It's as fundamental as that. And you know, that's known to archaeologists, it's nothing new. But I'm just telling you, I come from such a level of ignorance, but I ask all the questions. And I was very happy to ask that question because that leads to a lot of things that I can use to beat up people with on reviewing papers. But the answer to this question, is this all about studying ancient stuff? Is absolutely no. You do have to understand the past in order to do anything useful for the future. But our studies are really about the present and the future. So you can see, you know, the modern debates that you will read about in these proceedings are about the relation between philosophy and science. The question of how did life come about? I don't think there are any space papers there, fortunately, but I will just give you one point to ponder. In the past decade, over 8,000 exoplanets have been discovered. This is not, you know, this is not whatever propaganda, this is a fact. NASA or European Space Agency, the astronomers have managed to discover and practically confirm at least 8,000. I always take the view that much of what they report as a huge discovery is actually a fly sitting on top of the telescope lens and moving around. But if you don't believe that, you know, maybe there's some truth to this. 8,000. And our capability to look at these things is just beginning. Do you know how they detect these things? I'll tell you. They look at a pinpoint of light very steadily coming from a star. They see the light going down, blinking a little bit. And they keep looking. And they say that happens after, say, if somebody were looking at our sun, they'd say, hey, the same little difference in light occurred after 24 hours. And then the next 24 hours. So it's very regular. So I said, ah, that must be a planet with such an orbit. And they calculate what the mass must be if the distance, if the orbital period is there. So this is how this kind of stuff is being done. It is primitive, to put it mildly. And they can only look at a very small section of the sky so far. So what I'm telling you is that, so what is an exoplanet? It's a planet in an exosolar planet, which means a planet belonging to a solar system other than ours. Over 8,000 have been confirmed. At least 400 are considered to be Earth-like. You know, they're not like as huge as Jupiter, which is easier to see than Earth. At least 400. That doesn't mean that they all have, come, you know, cable TV and all this kind of stuff there yet. I hope not. But what does this mean? So this means that as the diagnostic techniques are getting better almost every year, but satellites had, you know, space missions are launched maybe every 5 years with a new, get better, and diagnostic techniques are going to get better. That is, I can be pretty sure that inside 20 years we will have a definite answer to the question of whether there is life as we know it elsewhere, not too far away from us. I don't know that. Maybe they will come out and say, no, we are really unique. What are the chances of that? So chances of life being anywhere are really, really small, maybe one in a billion. But in each galaxy, there are a billion stars. And there are about a billion galaxies. I think they throw out, astronomers throw out these billion numbers because they can't count beyond a certain level. Each star may have 10 planets. Now, what is the probability of one in a billion mean? This means that It's almost a slam dunk that there is going to be life as we know it to be found within what I call a reasonable distance, which is like, you know, 100 light years. Not that I can go there, but not millions of light years away. What will this do to human philosophy? Okay, and the easy answer is everybody will jump up and down and say the Hindus were right, bow to them. Do you think that is going to happen? Absolutely not. Already people are all fine-tuning their own belief systems to be able to claim that, this is what we have been saying. Okay? But I claim that, you know, it's up to us to decide whether we want to take leadership in this or let somebody else claim credit for this. Okay? But that's not the only thing that we should be thinking about. At the other end of the spectrum, what I've shown there on the on that side of the slide is actually the smallest machine that has been devised. I got it from some newspaper. It's only on the order of nanometers in diameter. If you look at that, do you see what I see? As a, you know, if I was sleeping in my own class, I would confuse the two pictures, the big wheel and the small wheel. There are some similarities there. How do you know what is life? This question is going to become much more important. Okay, and perhaps you reason that that whole galaxy is life. No, so I don't know. I don't want to get into that. But you see that there are really, really fundamental questions out there that have nothing to do with ancient stuff, but it's all about going into the future. We come with the knowledge base that should be used to powerfully go towards these things. And that is really what WAVES is all about. But that being said, a lot of people have put a lot of effort into making this conference happen. I'm so glad you're all here. Enjoy yourself. Thank you.